living waters as we gather in God's house and online to be reminded that we are loved by God, that we're saved through what Jesus does for us on the cross, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we're called back out into the world to share God's love and mercy with everyone we come in contact with. It is a glorious day for us to be together. There has been a lot taking place. And so a few things to draw your attention to. We just made it through the week of the garage sale. The garage sale was yesterday and Friday morning, starting Friday morning, and it was phenomenal. And so I'd like to invite Sarah to come up and share some stories. But as Sarah is coming up, anybody want to take a guess as to how much money we raised?
$100.
Oh. Whew. Higher than that.
$3,000
higher than that. A million. Oh, from your mouth to God's ears. Higher than 3,000. Make another guess. 4,055. With still some coming in. Yeah. Woohoo! That is more than what we raised last year. And it's not just about the money that was raised. There were stories of engagement with people in the congregation, with people in the community, which Sarah is going to share a few of those with us.
Sure. If you weren't here, you missed a lot. It's incredible to see all walks of life that make their way here. And I just wanted to share a few things that people have had experiences or who they encountered during the couple days that we were all here and had people coming. If you want to have some hope in the younger generation, and so happy and enjoyed themselves shopping throughout the whole morning or day, yesterday morning I think it was, and they were just so engaged with us at the checkout and were so sweet, and so what a heartwarming thing that was. And then we had another young man who had ridden his bike over here. He fell in love with the green lamp, which all of us workers were considering. And he was so polite. He said, well, if you guys really want it, you should have that then. He goes, I won't have to get it. I mean, he was just so thoughtful and polite. And I'm like, oh, no, you take that lamp. So he came back in two trips to get that lamp home on his bicycle. But he was just so sweet, thankful, and adorable.
Come up, yeah.
She can say it so much better.
The problem is if I'll start crying again.
Yeah, she said she might cry again. Oh. That's okay.
Hi, everyone. So yesterday we had just turned everything to free. So everything that, you know, you came in the door, everything was free. And a woman came in with an immigrant family, and we said, you know, where are you guys from? And they were refugees from Afghanistan. was just, and they filled the laundry basket with blankets to take home. And it was a family of 11, and they were so overjoyed by sheets and blankets. And if that doesn't tell you so much about the people around us and the gifts that we have to give that we don't even think about, and I don't know how to describe the look of joy on her face for a blanket. It was just one of those moments where I left going, oh, that's why we do what we do. So it was beautiful, really beautiful. And thank you, Sarah, and everyone for all the work.
Yeah, it was really quite amazing to see the needs that were being filled. So if you can consider coming next year, even for a couple hours to come participate, it's amazing. I do want to thank so many people, and I'm afraid to leave anyone out, but especially all the workers that came Friday and Saturday. There was a good crowd of us. We have also, I think, a ton of you that donated. We also had the school down the hall, their families donated. We actually had neighbors in our community that donated. And we had people that brought us good food, Gail. And we had all kinds of snacks and things, and it was fun to hand out candy and water and fun toys for the kids for free, so that was cool. But thank you everyone ever so much for helping make this a huge success. I think we had at least a couple dozen people involved this year, and it's quite amazing. And the last thing but not least, we do have a couple favors to ask you all. You still have a chance to participate. Get to before, but we do have back in the fellowship hall, I think this is that, what direction is that? West? Straight behind us. Going down. Okay. Well, anyway, along the far side, on the playground side of fellowship hall, is a wall of items that we need to get to Goodwill. If you are able to take a box or two, to help us get rid of those and drop that stuff off at the Goodwill, we would really appreciate it. And then we also do have a lot of boxes and garbage bags that are full. We're already overflowing our dumpster, and it does cost another monthly charge equal to a monthly charge to have an extra pickup come. So we're hoping if you have room in your garbage can at home, maybe you could just pick up a sack or a box or something to take home to throw away. Those are by the preschool opening doors on the parking lot side. So if you could grab something there, if you're willing to get rid of it for us, we'd really appreciate that as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah.
One other piece of the garage sale, a large portion of the things that were left behind also were collected by the Knights of Columbus in our area and are being transported up to the White Earth Reservation to help with ministries up there too. So the ministry was blessed here and now it's going on to bless other people. So if you can help with taking a box or two or seven, that would be wonderful. We encourage you to do that. We're also now, as we're getting into August, Vacation Bible School is coming up along with our Outdoor Summerfest, our big party in the backyard. You'll find out in the gathering space some postcards that you can take. We want to encourage you to invite your neighbor, invite your sister, your grandkids, the people around you. It's easier to tell them about something and hand them something with the information. So please pick those up as you go. And then finally today, we have a guest preacher with us, Emily Ronsberg. Emily preached here last summer with us on her pastoral internship to Oregon. She's now come home from internship and will be headed to her last year at Warburg Seminary. And so Emily was a youth in my former parish, and I have had the joy of walking with her through this, and I'm so thankful that you're here today to bring God's word to this part of God's family. So welcome. With that being said, let us begin worship with a confession and forgiveness. I invite you to stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we sing together our opening song, we invite the children in the church to gather quarters from the adults to bring up to our quarter pole. You can just hold the quarter in the air and the kids will come and receive it. Let us sing together.
Spirit of adoption, when you cry, Abba, Father. It is that very spirit that we are all children of God. And if children, they're heirs of God, and joint heirs of Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him, so we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revelation of the beauty of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been growing in labor pains until now, and not until the creations, but we ourselves who have had first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that it seems is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for our patience. We will read Psalms 86, 11 through 17. We'll read it responsibly. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name.
I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever.
For great is your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol.
O God, the insolent rise up against me. A band of ruffians seize my life. They do not substitute before them.
But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant. Save the child of your servant girl.
Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me.
At this time, we'd like to invite the children forward for the children's sermon. I know there's a few of you up here. Pastor or Emily here is going to teach us a little something.
Come on up,
guys.
Find a seat that's comfortable or a place that's comfortable.
I like daisies.
Daisies, they're really pretty. Any other kind of flowers?
A rose.
Roses? Yeah, what else? Great ones? Yes. Oh, definitely, they're all pretty great. Do you want to see what I have here? Do you want to see these things here? I'll come and
those are dandelions.
Bring this one. Yes, I have some dandelions. They can be strong even when things are really, really tough. They're might be assigned dandelion this week. And remember that God loves you so very much, that God wants and invites you to be resilient and be supportive of the loving people in your life, too. All right, should we pray really quick? Thank you, God, for giving us loving community and your love to keep us resilient in this moment. Help us to lean on the people who care for us when we need help. Thank you for your love for us today and in your name we pray. Amen.
Invite the congregation to stand as we sing the gospel acclamation.
Church on my very first day of internship, I was ecstatic to see that there were raspberry bushes all around me.
blackberry bushes and raspberry bushes are considered noxious weeds. So what's the difference between here and there? The difference is the climate, the different context that they are growing in. Here in the Midwest, we have a really short growing season, and as you all know, our winters can be pretty harsh. And so the raspberry plants that grow here grow thin and long and get as much sunlight as they can in a short amount of time. And so they're just focusing on getting their flowers and their berries, and that's what they really focus on. So they grow but slowly and grow pretty much in harmony with their neighbors. In the Pacific Northwest, however, raspberry bushes essentially grow year-round. They end up growing really large and really dense. When my dad came out to visit me, he couldn't believe that there was a raspberry bush in the house, the yard of the intern house, that was, if not quarter size, a little bit larger in thickness. So you can't imagine something like that growing out here. But anyway, they grow these gigantic leaves and thorns, and they end up shading out their neighbors and grow really, really dense. So they take over. And so instead of picking berries like I would have had done up here in the Midwest, I joined a group of people from the congregation to put on gloves and take out shovels and shears and worked on uprooting these noxious weeds from church property. So as I learned, my ability to judge what is useful or not, what is good or not, is limited by my lived experiences and my community context that I've grown up in and participated in. And I think that's true for a lot of us. We know what is familiar to us, but put in a different situation, the things that we've learned before might not serve us the exact same way. But God, however, was the very first gardener. We know from the creation stories in Genesis that it's pretty clear that God likes to take a hands-on approach to tending to God's creation. In today's parable from Jesus about the wheat and the weeds, and I'll do my best to enunciate both of those throughout the sermon here, it's only after all of the plants have grown up that the human workers are able to distinguish between the weeds and the wheat. They know this because the wheat bears grain, while the weeds do not. But before this, they're virtually identical to human eyes. It's interesting because the Greek word used for weeds here seems to have been commonly used to refer to a specific kind of weed, often called darnel or false wheat, because it looks very, very similar to wheat until grain develops. And actually, the idea that an enemy might have sown this into a field isn't entirely hypothetical. This weed was so problematic that sowing it into an enemy's field was practically the equivalent of a war crime in the ancient Near East. And it really wasn't until the invention of a modern sorting machinery that darnel seed could be efficiently sorted from seedwheat. So this is a very practical thing that Jesus is bringing to this community. They understand this quite well. So why is Jesus describing the kingdom of God as the site of a war crime? I think in part it's because that God likes to show up where we least expect God to be. There are some readings of this text that put people into one of two groups. Either you're a weed or you're a stalk of wheat. And personally, I find that reading both uninspiring and deeply problematic, because it leaves out God's love of tending to God's creation directly. To God, we are both wheat and weeds, both sinner and saint. And God has declared us to be forever God's children. And to God, again, the first gardener, the gardens of our hearts are the sites of a tragedy. Because God knows how our spirits are thirsty for hope.
how the grief of this world has choked out the sunlight and shaded the bright flowers that used to bloom with joy. God knows how we feel protected by the thorny hedges that we've erected at the edges of our comfort zones. But unlike us, God sees how they simply hold us back from deeper relationship with people that we simply don't know yet. Our human ability to judge what is useful or not, good or not, is limited by our lived experiences and by our community context. But God is the first and the best gardener and sees the beauty that each of us contains. And God would rather die on a cross than stop nurturing the beauty and the possibility that God sees in each one of you. Hope that is seen is not hope, but it is precisely in the possibilities that hope abounds. And it is in the currency of possibilities that the Holy Spirit works best. God, as our loving parent, gently cares for the overgrown and weeded patches of our hearts, the places and parts of ourselves we would maybe rather not see the light of day again. But through God's grace and mercy, we are opened up to the love and light that God is continually showering us with. And this same God beckons us out into the garden of the world, inviting us to see with God's eyes what might need to be pruned or reseeded to bear good fruit. So beloved, hear this. You are not a noxious weed, no matter what we might have done or left undone. You, as a beloved child of God, are a cornucopia of possibility whom God delights in tending to. You are God's adopted child, forever a co-heir with Christ. Rest in this sure and abundant hope.
together the Apostles' Creed.
Sustain your people living with HIV, AIDS, ministry to love on all, our education ministry to equip us for living faithfully, and our social ministry to enact the gospel in our community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We send faithful people to proclaim freedom from bondage and to renew your church. Encourage us by the witness of the faithful departed and comfort who are mourning, especially the families of Lauren, Pat, and Leah. Help us to live in the hope that you give through Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another.
Came to him saying, oh, 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 In a world where love hard to find, in a world where life's so unkind, give a silence and a witness, near enough to change.
Yeah.